Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me, Nikhil. I think a lot of ground was covered in the first section, so what I'd like to actually do is maybe give some of you some visibility into what we've been doing at Twitter and how we've been looking at this problem, because, you know, obviously fake news affects all of us and it affects our platform as well. And I'll try and give you some context after I give you this particular update of what happened around terrorism and terrorist accounts, just to give you an idea of, some of you spoke about, you know, how it's technology and that, you know, you need to apply technology to really solve the problem. We are taking a multi-pronged approach and we are actually trying to use AI and machine learning. So let me give you a couple of updates, after which I think you'll get a sense of the scale of what we're trying to do, and then I'd be happy to kind of answer some questions. So some of the big thoughts that we have right now around what our platform actually is meant for is really, I think Twitter looks at itself as a platform that's meant to keep people informed about what's happening in the world. And it's that platform where you can come and you can kind of say what's happening and what are these people doing. And you have access now, you know, to a lot of people that maybe you didn't 10 years ago. And you can hear from people directly and hear from different kinds of accounts. And we, of course, do allow pseudonyms and anonymity to protect that space for people who might want to speak about issues but may not want to use their real names. So that's sort of one area that we believe in. The other area which, you know, which has been talked about a little bit in that fact-checking context is that we do believe that on a certain level our platform actually does also, if used correctly, you know, provide an antidote to a lot of the misinformation and fake news that goes around, because you do have a lot of journalists on the platform and you do have a lot of interesting people on the platform who are able to, and from what I can make out, with, you know, a lot more speed and accuracy now do their job. So I think Saikat was talking about, you know, news needs to fact check. I think people are actually able to do that, and we've got, of course, fact checkers who you'll hear from, but they are able to actually counter a lot of narratives that we see going on the platform, and that's really interesting to watch. The other point, I think, which was, I think Cyril, is it, who also mentioned this, is, you know, the term of fake news. I think after what's been happening in the US, the term fake news started kind of getting used in many different ways and not probably in the way that it started. So, yeah, so that's why we also look at fake news, but we also look at misinformation and disinformation, and we're kind of thinking around approaches. But I'm going to focus a little bit on what we've done, which is a little more to do with AI machine learning. You know, we are automated systems. We catch more, sorry, and I'm using a paper because I'm really bad at numbers, so I don't want to mess up, but, you know, we catch more than 3.2 million suspicious accounts globally per week. And that's actually double the amount that we were able to capture about a year ago. And you know, in our monthly active users, we don't actually add these numbers into it. So what I'm trying to tell you is that we have, you know, we have these suspicious accounts that are operating on the platform. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to put technology to try and catch these actors. And we're doing pretty well, I think, as a good start. And we're catching these 3.2 million suspicious accounts globally a week. And one of the theories behind bots is really that you should get so good that you're able to catch these guys before they can actually start acting on the platform. Before, so when they create the account, you actually are able to stop them at the point of creation so that they don't actually get to even their first tweet. So, you know, we catch up to, I think, 523,000 suspicious logins in a day. And I'll kind of get into that a little bit. But, you know, a lot of this is being done through machine learning and automatic spam and bot detection tools, the details of some of which we don't give out because we don't want the bad actors to understand exactly how we do it. But, you know, we can tell you how it's working, and hopefully we'll be able to kind of improve upon that. But we're finding that we're able to improve this activity almost like at a 64% increase year on year. So we're heartened by that. And like I said, you know, we're investing in systems to actually stop these bad actors at the point of origin, which is a very important strategy. We're also trying to detect, and some of you might be familiar with this, but, you know, there are cluster accounts. A single entity, a suspicious source, has actually created clusters of accounts that are now going to actually amplify this content on the platform. So, you know, we've used techniques and we've actually managed to catch 5.7 million accounts that way. So just to give you a scale of how things are operating. You know, detecting non-human activity patterns. So I think some of you in India also might be a little familiar with this part of it, and of course false positives, is that sometimes people can get caught up in these filters that we are putting out because we're trying to catch, you know, bot-like behavior, and it's not normal for a human being to, like, tweet so many times in a day, or maybe tweet the exact same phrase again and again. Like, it's not normal, and what happens is that sometimes our filters, which are still, you know, kind of learning, may catch someone. It may be a false positive, and then we'll put them back in the system when we realize. We might ask them to maybe do a CAPTCHA, you know, just to tell us that they're a real person, or in some cases maybe verify your phone number. I know that if it happens to someone, they get, you know, they get really shocked, and you know, it can become a story depending on who they are, but it is part of our process to try and you know, fix and make the system healthier. So again, let me just see, with third-party apps, of course, I've talked about improving phone verification. So like I mentioned, we've had in the last couple of years, you know, big themes that have come into how social media has been used by, say, bad actors, right? I mean, the good we know about, so I won't really bother kind of telling you all that. I think a lot of people over here have reaped the benefits of social media, and certainly of Twitter. I think a lot of you I know from Twitter, even if I don't know you. But yeah, in terms of, you know, bad actors, we've had a lot of work done in the last 2 years around abuse, because we found that abuse was something that was becoming a bit, you know, a big problem. It still is a big problem. And we looked at that also from two points of view. One was, you know, we have to weigh our policies according to when we made them last, and then what they are today, and we have to see if abuse patterns are actually evolving and whether our policies need to be updated. So, for example, we had a policy which focused exactly on terrorism and promoting terrorism and incitement. In the last few weeks, we've actually updated the policy to talk about violent groups that may not be terrorist groups. Now, this is something because of, like, activity on the platform and kind of seeing the cases, we realize the need, and I do understand that we need to anticipate future behavior so that we're not catching, but this is kind of how things are done. On the other end, you know, we have different modes given to the user. One is things that all of you may have seen if you're Twitter users, which is you can report a lot more easily now. You know, tweets come up. We ask you, of course, for context because it's all speech and there is context involved. But at the same time, you know, from our end, our enforcement is also things that you may or may not see. So, for example, if someone is caught, we may actually ask the person to just lock the person out of their account. So a lot of times you won't know, you know, and you'll be like, this person, there's been no action taken against this person. But actually that person's been quiet for 12 hours or 24 hours. And actually that should give you an indication that this person is probably locked out of their account, because we give them a timeout and we hope that maybe they won't repeat this behavior. So similarly, we have other things that we try, including telling people which tweets to delete. You know, those are kind of actions that we take. Now, what happens a lot of times is that when there are accounts which are on timeout behavior and all that, you know, our open APIs, which are there, and actually we are the platform that really gives researchers open APIs, and so that's why a lot more research is done on Twitter, I think, than other platforms. It doesn't actually accurately show these kind of modes of enforcement. So when you're looking at that, so I think it's really important for researchers also to come to us a lot of times when they've done research and ask us to actually re-verify some of what they're doing. My colleagues in the US and the UK are able to work with academic institutions. So I know I don't, I have not been given, you know, too much time, but I'll just end on, one more thing. I think another pattern which is emerging, which is something which is very relevant to what's happening here, and I'm, you know, all ears for ideas and thought around this, is human directed accounts, because, you know, as everything with India, we can subsidize the work a lot, and maybe we're not using machines and using people a little bit, so we're also trying to find those clusters of bad behavior. But yeah, this is a growing problem in some markets. We're not alone. You know, we've got this in Mexico and some of the other countries as well, but this is a challenge for us, and we are looking at, you know, it's a little trickier for us because somebody might be involved with a certain type of amplification, but actually their account is a human account and they use it for regular speech, and so it's not as easy as to identify them as we would a bot account. So yeah, so those are just some of the big ticket things. I just wanted you guys to get a context of the fact that the scale is really big. We have about 1 billion tweets every 2 days. You know, it's a lot of speech going through our platforms. And so we're actually applying technology at some extent to try and catch a lot of this behavior, the kind of behavior that we can catch and that we know that we can take care of. And then there'll be other kinds of behavior that we'll have to talk a little more about in terms of what should be the policy of a platform like Twitter looking at some of these issues. Yeah.
So one of the things that I'm curious about is about, you've talked about hate speech and talked about abuse. How do you deal with misinformation? And because that's something which your platform isn't really, it doesn't seem to be geared up to do or looking into. I've reported a lot of abuse in the past, and invariably quite a bit of it has been taken care of.
So, you know, and I know this is the big question, and I'll be quite frank with you. Over here, what we're doing is, on one aspect of misinformation is what I said. Like, you know, there are certain behavior patterns of these like automated malicious bot systems that we know that we can tackle.
So I'm kind of asking about verified accounts putting out fake information.
No, so let me kind of get to that. We don't have a fake news policy. We don't have a fake news policy currently, okay. And I don't want to say that we do. Of course, we don't. I think it's something that we have to give some thought over. I don't know if you want Twitter to be the arbiter of this is true or this is not, because what's fake to you, somebody else will come to us, and certainly I can tell you that I have a lot of different people getting in touch with me saying that guy is not okay or this person is not okay, and we don't want to necessarily be in that space. So how do we actually deal with this? I think it's something that we are still in the midst of wondering about. One of the things that we think that we can do from the platform point of view is, we know who the trusted accounts are. Certainly, I think verification to a large degree, but we are also rethinking the verification. The public verifications are closed, and only elected officials to a large extent are getting verified at this point. That's a separate problem. I can't speak to that. We don't have a fake news policies yet, but I think that we can elevate some of the good content. Accounts that we know are doing good work in our discover bar now. It's a lot more than trending hashtags. I mean, it's getting into moments. It's getting into videos. It's getting into popular articles, etc. So I think there are other ways for you to actually see a holistic story on the platform. And actually, it's not only about shielding you from what you don't want to see, but actually seeing that whole 360 circle. And that's something that's possible on our platform. And I think that's the strength of our platform. So that's something that we're thinking about.
Here's a question and a thought.
Yeah, please.
Right? We've spoken, several people have spoken about debunking fake news.
Yeah.
Right? I think that's an opportunity that you have. I understand that you don't want to come in the way of what is fake and not. Yeah. But once something has been established, right, I think there's an opportunity for you to voice so more people know, number one. Number two, I think, I don't know if you do that, but maybe there's another opportunity to, once again, some content has been established as fake, right, this actor passed on, right, or RIP messages have been posted, there's an opportunity to perhaps force delete those messages so that it doesn't perpetuate. Mm-hmm. I think these are two really simple solutions without coming in anyone's way, that you could, as a very important player in the news business, so to say, can possibly act upon.
So, just one of the, I'm going to take the example of one of the accounts, which is on Twitter. It's a verified account. Has said things like "ek ek mia ko kaatna hai." Has put out multiple fake news. The account is IP Patel.
Pratik, that's hate speech. We're not going.
No, but
to
this account is responsible for both fake news and hate speech. And what happens in multiple cases is that they get taken down or get penalized, and in many cases they get suspended. And then somebody runs a trend: I support this person, and magically that account is unsuspended. How does that happen?
Okay, so I can't speak to individual cases, so I can answer in hypotheticals, perhaps, if that's more helpful. When accounts are reported to us, if the tweets are still active on the platform and not been deleted, we can take action on those tweets. The second thing is that we have, we have layers of enforcement, so sometimes people are asked to, say, delete a tweet, and that's why, if they do that, they are given a second opportunity to stay on the platform. It is some people who are permanently suspended from the platform when they are repeat offenders, and they, certainly don't show any signs of improving. It is possible sometimes that there has been a mistake in our end in terms of a suspension for whatever reason. And each and every person over here is allowed to file a, appeal suspension case, and our agents will re-review it. Because human error again is possible. So hypothetically, it's possible that there was an error. I don't know about the specifics of the case that you're mentioning, but that would be the way things would happen. But certainly, if the same account was reported and caught for repeat behavior, that would be then action. So
I just wanted to ask about propaganda. So there are instances which people have pointed out where there are fake bots, I don't know, human-operated bots who just copy-paste tweets, and that becomes like a trending thing. Yeah. Because one thing that Twitter does is amplify a lot of things, which might include fake news. Mm. So I just wanted to ask if you're taking any action against these sort of copy-pasted trends and, whatever we are seeing, basically political propaganda.
Yeah. So like I mentioned, in the case of automated, we are definitely, as I had mentioned, we're taking a lot of action. I think in the case of human, networks, we are also working on it. We are working on it. We definitely don't want the trends to be manipulated from both points of view. One is that, you know, it's not a great user experience. I mean, if you were to come and see trends and you realize the first two, three trends are not actually genuine trends, as a user, you're not going to enjoy the platform. Secondly, for us, it's gaming our system, and we don't actually appreciate that at all. So those are very important issues for us, and we are definitely working on them. I can't speak to the specifics of it because there's a lot more machine and automation involved than I understand at an individual level. But it is a problem, and we are looking. If you have... Yeah, that's my answer. We have teams internally at Twitter that look at trust in... Well, we don't give out information about who... They are experts in speech issues, and they are trained, and they're given a lot of cultural context. As you can well imagine, we can't give out details of who these people are because they will be harassed, as some of us who are publicly known are, in any case, So they are, you know, they are obviously people who are well trained, and they are trained in our policies, they're trained in understanding cultural context, and we keep doing refresher trainings because what also happens is that, the you know, a lot of the words that are used, sometimes the references that are used are extremely new because something has happened in the country and suddenly you're using those references. So we continue with our agents. Some of them within the teams would have more knowledge about one country. They are language specialists. And we have something called the Trust and Safety Team at Twitter. And these people sit within the Trust and Safety Team. And that's a team which has a number of different arms, including teams that look into, like, safety-related policy issues. You'll have people who are actually, like, you know, looking at user services. So the people that you're talking about, you'll have other engineering people in it. It's a pretty holistic group of people. So I think that's a really interesting suggestion. I think in the context of what we're discussing, like trying to track the source of fake news, it is...
Who's the first person to post it?
I think that making these kind of things public, I have to take a lot more thought because there's a lot of law enforcement around the world and there'll be a lot of people tracking dissidents and hashtags, including maybe what some of you are doing, just to find out who's the first person who started it. And I don't know, we want to give out that kind of user information and make our users... So I think it's an interesting idea. I think that a lot more thought... I've written it down, so I do appreciate it, but you have to look at the same solution and see it from all angles of what the uses could be, and we have to protect our users, the genuine users. Yeah.
I come from a legal background, so I just wanted to ask you, in interacting with the legal or regulatory framework, if you had like a wish list or one top challenge that you face in that domain, what would it be? Or what would you like to see changed? How does Twitter interact with, you know, the law on online platforms, intermediaries, and things like that?
To be quite honest, I will not give the wish list, but I'll tell you that it's not to do with fake news at this point. It's a different... I think a lot more capacity building has to happen with law enforcement to understand social media, you know, what the platforms are, how they work. And I think that's definitely on my wish list.
So education of law enforcement.
Yeah, I think I do feel sometimes, and this is not an official Twitter statement, but this is just me saying it, but I do feel that, you know, in Delhi and other bigger cities, we do have an understanding, and even police for that matter would be a little more cognizant of the laws, freedom of expression. I think in smaller places there's a lot more pressure to just take things down, or, you know, so I do feel that there should be a lot more capacity building of law enforcement, and we should be able to kind of tell them how our platforms work, because they're complicated platforms, and platforms are coming up every day, and it's a lot to kind of deal with, so...